Welcome back to the series that absolutely nobody asked for, Taylor Swift History. I'm your host, a crazy woman with far too much time on her hands. Last time we talked about Taylor Swift's phenomenal, show-stopping sophomore album, Fearless. It was an era in which she gained mainstream success, she won Album of the Year at the Grammys, and got to date Joe Jonas and Taylor Lautner in the process. Today we'll be talking about Taylor's most honest album to date. In this era, we really see her rise to like mainstream superstardom and all of the joys and controversies that come with that. And these will all, of course, be arranged in a timeline that coincides with my third grade school year because this series is, after all about me. Today we'll be talking about Taylor Swift's incredible third studio album, 2010's Speak Now. Before we get into Speak Now, I want to address a couple things that should have gone in the last video, but I forgot. First of all, in May of 2008, Taylor attends her first ever Met Gala. The theme was superheroes, fashion, and fantasy. She wore this gown by Badgley Mischka. I think she played it safe as far as Met Gala looks go, but she slayed nonetheless. Also, Taylor and Lucas Till, who is the sexy cowboy from the Hannah Montana movie, and also the love interest in the You Belong With Me video, they did in fact date very, very briefly in 2009. So for those of you keeping track, this is post Joe Jonas, but pre-Taylor Lautner. Lucas Till told MTV in December of 2009, quote, "We dated for a little bit, but there was no friction because we were both too nice. We both really liked each other, but really I just liked her as a friend. That's the only reason it didn't work out." When asked to choose between Miley Cyrus and Taylor as to who the better kisser is, he did choose Taylor. So as you can see, there's nothing but incredible, hard-hitting journalism coming out of MTV News in 2009. Another very small moment from 2009 that is entirely inconsequential but really important for me to mention as someone who watched The Ellen Show every single day after school with my mom. Ellen was famous for just scaring the living shit out of her guests all the time. I don't know why this became a thing she did. And the video of Ellen scaring Taylor went viral for the time, because it is quite hilarious. Taylor does get very, very scared. There was a single released during the Fearless era that I forgot to mention, Today Was a Fairy Tale. This was a song that Taylor had just like on hand, and then when she got cast in the movie Valentine's Day, she offered it to the producers, and it ends up in the end credits of the movie. It's just a really, really sweet song about like perfect first date. Taylor decided to include this on the Fearless Taylor's Version vault track, so it is canonically included in the Fearless era. Another Met Gala occurred in what is technically the Fearless era. In May 2010, Taylor attended once again when the theme was American Woman, Fashioning a National Identity. She went for this pretty understated Ralph Lauren look, which really embodied the sophisticated, good girl, quote-unquote clean look that she tended to gravitate to during this era. Finally, I wanted to include a little bit of an update since the last video was posted. As you know, I was absolutely thirsting over acquiring the Beautiful Eyes EP CD.
If you own the Beautiful Eyes CD in 2022, you need to lock your windows at night because you are number one on my home invasion list.
It was my birthday last month and my dear friend Fiona scoured the internet and she got me it, and it is beautiful and I'm so excited. I'm so excited that I have this. The songs are great. Video content goes crazy. It's just very exciting. So this has completed my collection. Anyway, that's enough Fearless talk. Let's get to Speak Now. So as I did in the last video, I want to start this video off with reading the prologue for this album, because as I said last time, like, they just give us a really good insight into Taylor's songwriting process, her ideas about the album, as well as they're just beautiful passages. So in the lyric book for Speak Now, it's the first page here and I'm gonna read it. "Speak now or forever hold your peace. The words said by preachers at the end of wedding ceremonies all over the world right before the vows. It's a last chance for protest, a moment that makes everyone's heart race, and a moment I've always been strangely fascinated by. So many fantasize about bursting into a church, saying what they'd kept inside for years like in the movies. In real life, it rarely happens. Real life is a funny thing, you know. In real life, saying the right thing at the right moment is beyond crucial. So crucial, in fact, that most of us start to hesitate for fear of saying the wrong thing at the wrong time. But lately, what I've begun to fear more than that is letting the moment pass without saying anything. I think most of us fear reaching the end of our life and looking back regretting the moments we didn't speak up, when we didn't say I love you, when we should have said I'm sorry, when we didn't stand up for ourselves or someone who needed help. These songs are made up of words I didn't say when the moment was right in front of me. These songs are open letters. Each is written with a specific person in mind, telling them what I meant to tell them in person. To the beautiful boy whose heart I broke in December. To my first love, who I never thought would be my first heartbreak. To my band. To a mean man I used to be afraid of. To someone who made my world very dark for a while. To a girl who stole something of mine. To someone I forgive for what he said in front of the whole world. Words can break someone into a million pieces, but they can also put them back together. I hope you use yours for good, because the only words you'll regret more than the ones left unsaid are the ones you use to intentionally hurt someone. What you say might be too much for some people. Maybe it will come out all wrong and you'll stutter and you'll walk away embarrassed, wincing as you play it all back in your head. But I think the words you stop yourself from saying are the ones that will haunt you the longest. So say it to them, or say it to yourself in the mirror. Say it in a letter you'll never send, or in a book millions might read someday. I think you deserve to look back on your life without a chorus of resounding voices saying, I could've, but it's too late now. There's a time for silence. There is a time for waiting your turn. But if you know how you feel, and you so clearly know what you need to say, you'll know it. I don't think you should wait. I think you should speak now. Love, Taylor. P.S. To all the boys who inspired this album, you should have known. So this album has a very distinct concept to it, as we read in the prologue just now. And while all of her songwriting is extremely personal up to this point and is an opportunity to say what she wanted to say, she has this very, very specific intention in mind with this album. The years that serve as inspiration for this album, which were like 2008 to 2010, are when she's 19, 20, 21 years old. So it's obviously a very, very crucial time in her coming of age, and it's honestly why this album is particularly special to me right now. I just turned 21, like I relate to a lot of what she went through and what inspired this album now. She's also far less idealistic about love. In this album, it's a lot more real as she's gaining more and more experience. There's less of that like fairy tale, like fantasy, and more truth. Not that before that she was like lying or anything, but it was more like of a fantasy before, and now it's more real. So this album was actually originally supposed to be called Enchanted. That's the name of, in my opinion, one of the best songs on this album. But Public Enemy number one, Scott Borchetta, didn't like it. And so Taylor thought about it. She picked a different song title from the album, and she thought Speak Now worked better, which I kind of agree with. Another very key part of this album is that Taylor is the sole songwriter on the whole thing. There is one bonus track in which she's a co-writer, but every other song she wrote completely by herself. And at the time when interviewers asked her about this, she said it was mostly out of necessity, like she kind of did it by accident, because she was on the Fearless tour for the majority of the writing of this album, and she would get ideas in the middle of the night or in the middle of Europe and wouldn't have anyone there to finish the song with her, so she would just finish it herself. But I also think a big part of this was as she was gaining a lot of success, especially winning Album of the Year for Fearless, and because she was so young and the music was so good, people were like, there's no way a teenage girl did this. They thought she was some kind of like industry plant or something. And she took that criticism and was like, okay, I'll write an entire album by myself to prove that I am doing the songwriting here. So the Fearless tour ends in June of 2010, thereby ending the Fearless era. Only a month later, July 20th, 2010, Taylor goes on this now archaic video streaming platform called Ustream and announces that her next album would be coming out on October 25th and that the first single, Mine, would be coming out later in August. Watching this live stream now is very fascinating to me for a couple reasons. For one, this is peak boho chic wearing headbands the wrong way era, which was for some reason incredibly popular in like the late 2000s, early 2010s. She's kind of dressed like a baby. I hate to say it. It's just such an odd fashion choice, but one I followed, like, to a T in, like, third and fourth grade. But it's also funny looking back on it now because this album announcement is really low-key and chill, and she announces the album simply because a fan asked about it in the comments. And it's just funny when comparing it to her later album releases and announcements, which are far more elaborate. So the first single to be released during this era, it's also the first track on the album, it's a song called Mine. The song ended up getting leaked, so they released it 2 weeks early, but it still shot to the top of the charts anyway. The song is about Taylor coming to terms with her tendency to run away from love because of her fear of heartbreak. This is particularly highlighted with the songs and subsequent music videos references to her parents' marriage, which quietly ended in divorce sometime in 2011, around the time of the album's release. In the song, Taylor meets somebody who changes these fears for her, and she kind of imagines a whole life together with them, like right upon meeting them. And there were rumors that this song was inspired by Corey Monteith, who it was rumored that they briefly dated in early 2010, but there's not a lot to back that up. And also the liner note is Toby, so I'm assuming it's about somebody named Toby. That could also just be, who knows. The song was featured on Glee though. In season 4, episode 4, Santana sings this song to Britney, and it is so very sweet. The music video features Taylor entering what can only be described as literally the diner from Twilight, and is thinking about her parents' divorce while she looks over the menu, as one does. Then a cutie patootie walks over to take her order, and she then imagines an entire life together with him, complete with their first date, first apartment, their wedding, fighting in the kitchen, having two beautiful blonde children, while meanwhile, singing Taylor stands in a field of hanging photographs. It all kind of gives Shutterfly commercial, but in the best possible way. This is also the first time Taylor directs her own music video. She co-directs it with Roman White, who directed the You Belong With Me and 15 music videos. The song received mostly really positive reviews from critics, and it peaked at number 3 on the Billboard Hot 100. So almost exactly 1 year after the infamous Kanye Taylor incident at the 2009 VMAs, Taylor returns to the VMA stage in 2010, on September 12th, about a week after my 9th birthday. The song did not end up becoming a single, but she specifically chose to perform it barefoot, for whatever reason, because it's about her forgiving Kanye for interrupting her acceptance speech at the 2009 VMAs, which is very sweet in theory, but personally I find this song to be incredibly patronizing. I think it's a nice song when you don't listen to it in context, but some of the lyrics are a little bit much for the situation. We'll get into that more once we do the album deep dive, but those are just kind of my initial thoughts on this decision to perform this song. So around this time, fall 2010, Taylor decides to go to a dinner party hosted by Gwyneth Paltrow and then husband Chris Martin. And there she is introduced to Jake Gyllenhaal. So the two are first publicly seen together in October of 2010, backstage at a taping of SNL. Randomly enough, it was a night when Emma Stone was hosting, and they're both pretty good friends with her. They went to go support her, and they arrived together. So this started sparking rumors. Then they're seen all over New York together. She spends Thanksgiving with his family in upstate New York. They get maple lattes in Brooklyn. They argue in Jake's car in LA, etc., etc. Very important to point out here that Taylor is 20 years old. And Jake Gyllenhaal is 29 years old. And we'll of course come to see that this relationship is unfortunately doomed from the start, and they break up sometime around January. So, for those of you keeping track thus far as famous boyfriends go, we have Joe Jonas, which was about July 2008 to October 2008. We have Lucas Till, very briefly, early 2009. We have Taylor Lautner, fall 2009, to December 2009. We have John Mayer, December 2009 to about February 2010. And now we have Jake Gyllenhaal, October 2010 to about January 2011. I hope you're taking notes. I really hope you're taking notes on this. There will be a quiz, so. So both the standard and the deluxe versions of the album come out on October 25th, and just as Taylor did with Fearless, she goes on the Ellen Show to celebrate. And once again, Ellen does what Ellen does best, which is talk about the music for like 5 seconds and then publicly embarrass her guests by bringing up all these rumors about them and their dating life. She brings up John Mayer, she brings up Jake Gyllenhaal. And Taylor's a little bit more coy this time with Fearless. When Ellen brought up Joe Jonas, Taylor was very straight to the point, like, yeah, he dumped me over the phone, which is iconic and hilarious. This time she was a little more like, I don't know what you're talking about, Ellen, whatever. Just a classic Ellen moment. But anyway, the album is now out in the world. Not to flex, but I own the Target Deluxe version of the album, which means she's wearing a red dress on the cover rather than a purple dress, which is what the standard album looks like. Despite owning the deluxe version, however, I hardly ever listened to the bonus tracks as a kid, because to get to them, you had to like fucking shatter the CD case to get to them, because it's on the other side, and I could literally never get to them. So I like hardly ever listened to the bonus tracks on this album anyway. So the back cover has the list of songs in this really pretty but impossible to read font. And her standing in this flowy yellow dress. Opening the CD case, we have the normal CD with all her team's hands in the middle spelling out Speak Now. The deluxe disc is on the back, has this cool watercolor design, and the inside cover has the photo from the disc of her team's hands. We have some really gorgeous images in the lyric book. Once again, they all kind of give TJ Maxx meets Shutterfly commercial, but they really emulate the vibe of the songs they're paired with. The image for Speak Now in particular is so visceral to me. This was by far my favorite when I would flip through this book as a kid. All right, we have an outfit change, which can only mean one thing, and it's definitely not that I didn't have time to film all of this video in one day, but rather that it's time for the track-by-track deep dive into this album. So as I said before, the album starts off with Mine, and then we get into an absolute banger, also known as Sparks Fly. Sparks Fly is, in my opinion, Taylor's horniest song to date. It's basically about trying and failing to resist somebody that you know is bad for you. The interesting thing about this song is that it was actually written super long time ago, like pre-debut era. Taylor was like 15 or 16 when she originally wrote this song. And it was about the country music artist Jake Owen, who she performed with in Portland, Oregon. And that's what the liner note of this song is, which is how people have figured this out. And she performed it live a few times, like in the debut era, and the fans loved it so much that they were like begging her to put this on her upcoming album. So she made a few alterations to it and put it on the album. If you're further interested in the history of this song, just look up Taylor Swift's Sparks Fly original version. It's very fascinating stuff to a crazy woman like me. This is such a good song. It's very like epic, kind of dramatic, which we'll see is kind of a musical theme throughout this album. The song gets released as a single in July of 2011, and the accompanying music video features a compilation of footage from the Speak Now World Tour, which I think really encapsulates the highlights of the tour and all of her most iconic performances. And also, Sparks Fly was the first song on the set list for the tour, so I think it's a very fitting video for it. The next song is Back to December. This is an absolutely gorgeous song that Taylor wrote about regretting breaking up with somebody. The liner note for this song is Tay, and we all know it's been confirmed many a time that this song is in fact about her breaking up with Taylor Lautner in December of 2009. If you remember from the last video, she broke up with him in December and started dating John Mayer also in December. It's basically just about saying that she regrets breaking his heart, she regrets how things ended, and it's just like a really beautiful apology of sorts. Back to December was the second single released for this era. It was released in November of 2010, and it generally got really good reviews, and it peaked at number 6 on the US Billboard Hot 100. While I love this song, the music video doesn't do a whole lot for me. It switches back and forth between this guy who's wandering around a high school track for some reason and her being upset in a cardigan at her house. And then it starts snowing inside the house. She writes him a note and sticks it in his jacket pocket, which he finds at the end. It's a perfectly fine video and really captures the essence of the song, but when compared to some of her other videos, which are literally like short films, this one falls a little short for me personally. It's also extremely important to me that you know that when she performed the song on the Speak Now tour in Grand Rapids, Michigan, which is the state that Taylor Lautner is originally from, she changed the lyric, so if the chain is on your door, I understand, to, so this is for the boy from Michigan, and the crowd went wild. I go back in time and change it, but I can't. Again, another inconsequential kind of detail, but very important to me that you know that. Next, we come to the titular track, Speak Now. This song is a fictional story of Taylor breaking up a wedding when the preacher says, speak now or forever hold your peace. And Taylor said this was about a friend of hers who was thinking of getting back together with her ex from high school, and when she went to reach out to him, she found out he was getting married, and they kind of like fantasized about breaking up this wedding, and Taylor wrote this absolute banger of a song about it. The liner note is, you always regret what you don't say. Next, we come to track five. This is the track five to end all track fives. It is the show-stopping, life-changing Dear John. I could write a dissertation on why Dear John is a brilliant song, and I'm about to right now, so enjoy. So the song details mistreatment that Taylor faced from a much older man, obviously John Mayer. If you'll remember from the last video, she was 19 and he was 32 when they dated, and they broke up in February of 2010 after about 3 months of dating. So first I want to talk about how brilliant the title of the song is. So a Dear John letter is a letter that a woman would write to her boyfriend, husband, etc., breaking up with them. And it was usually because they were stationed overseas. I think this came about in like World War I or World War II. And these came to be known as a Dear John letter. That's basically what this song is. I mean, she's basically saying like, here's why it's terrible. And and what's so brilliant is that she's talking about a guy named John. But theoretically, the song could be about anyone because it's Dear John. It could be whoever. And I think that's just so clever. It's such a clever way of putting his name in, but also she could still be coy about it and be like, well, it could be about anybody. Second of all, you'll notice that the song sounds pretty different from her sound thus far. It's got this kind of like sultry electric guitar throughout it that is pretty reminiscent of John Mayer's like signature sound, and I think that's also just so brilliant. She like made a song that he would write and he would listen to, but it's about how like shitty and terrible he is. Taylor writes with this gut-wrenching poetic sharpness, referencing their age gap, his problematic dating history, and just how much of a terrible dick he was to her. And in keeping with that image, John Mayer himself told Rolling Stone that the song, quote, really humiliated him. It made him feel terrible. And reduced it to cheap songwriting, which is hilarious because this is the same guy who, in our Year of the Lord 2021, released a song called Why You Know Love Me. Why you know love me? Why you know love me? The liner note for this song is, I loved you from the very first day. We will see that comes up again later in one of the bonus tracks. Now, track six is a little song called Mean. This is a t-shirt that I got. When would I have gotten this? I think I was probably like 11 or 12 when I got this, because Mean was my favorite song on this album when I was a kid. And this ended up becoming like the biggest hit from this album, as we'll see. It's a banjo heavy, fun little country song, and it's Taylor's first of what would ultimately become many songs just sticking it to the haters. It was specifically inspired by a moment that I told you to keep track of from the last video, and being the good students you are, I know you wrote it down, so If you want to look back in your notes, we can recall that. So Taylor sang Rhiannon with Stevie Nicks at the 2010 Grammys and got a shit ton of hate for the performance. Even though, in my opinion, maybe it's a biased opinion, but I really don't think it was that bad. And a review by the infamous blogger Bob Lefsetz was particularly cruel and was ultimately the catalyst for her writing this song. He said in a February 2010 blog post titled Grammys, quote, "In one fell swoop, Taylor Swift consigned herself to the dustbin of teen phenoms." Phenoms? I don't even know what that word is. "Who we expect to burn brightly and fade away. Taylor's too young and dumb to understand the mistake she made, and those surrounding her are addicted to cash and are afraid to tell her no. But last night, Taylor Swift should have auto-tuned. Taylor Swift shortened her career last night. And since she calls all her own shots, she has to shoulder the blame. Yes, her dream came true, she made it, she's a star, but the real test is longevity. Will Taylor Swift be duetting the stars of the 2030s? Doubtful." Reading this article nowadays is hilarious because this just couldn't be further from the truth, but obviously Taylor didn't know that at the time, and this is her first, like, really major, very public, very mainstream criticism. So she wrote this song calling him a liar, pathetic, alone in life, and mean. The song was released as a single in March 2011 and peaked at number 11 on the US Billboard Hot 100. The accompanying music video is set as a kind of play within a video showing Taylor singing with her band in this Depression-era chic set. Then it shows a kid who is implied to perhaps be gay, getting bullied by football players, a fast food worker getting made fun of by her peers, and the sheer, gargantuan, unbridled talents of Miss Joey King getting excluded from the lunch table, dressed in her Easter best for some reason. Taylor is also seen getting tied up on a set of train tracks like she's in a silent movie. By the end of the video, each of the characters have overcome their challenges and become much more successful than their respective bullies, and it ends with Joey King slaying in the audience. Overall, it's a fun video and drives home more of an anti-bullying message than Taylor's own personal beef with the guy who inspired the song. Overall, this is a very fun song. Again, it was my favorite when I was a kid, hence why I asked for this shirt. And the liner note is, "I thought you got me." The next song is the hype as fuck, The Story of Us. The Story of Us is about running into your ex in public and just not knowing how to act, and that, like, awkwardness and tension of that situation. It is thought to have been inspired by the 2010 CMT Awards, when Taylor was sat just 6 seats away from John Mayer when they had recently broken up only like a month or two before. The liner note for this song is CMT Awards, so I think that's a pretty fair assumption. The song was released as a single in April 2011, but it wasn't a huge hit of hers commercially. It peaked at 41 on the US Billboard Hot 100, and I feel like it doesn't have the same kind of mainstream success that a lot of her other singles do. But regardless, this is one of my favorites on the whole album. It's just so fun and clever. Everybody's been there. I remember in 8th grade, I had a huge falling out with one of my best friends. But we still had a lot of classes together, and we rode the same bus, and I remember it just being so awkward, and we, like, weren't speaking to each other, and we'd, like, sit far away from each other, and I would listen to this song and be like, this is literally my life right now. The music video for this song is incredible. They chose to take a dark academia approach, and they first show how Taylor and this guy met, spent cutesy time together in the library, but then he kisses another girl there, and now they're cramming for a test with a bunch of other students. They realize they're in the same library and don't know how to act anymore. This is alternated with footage of Taylor going absolutely ham in this aisle of books, just absolutely doubled over in angst, ponytail in shambles, etc., etc. It ends with this huge dance party, the two finally meet again, decide it's over for good, and go their separate ways. Overall, this is probably one of my favorite music videos of hers of all time. The vibes of it are just so spot on and gorgeous. It's dramatic enough to match the song, and I love it. The next track takes a very dramatic shift in tone with the very bittersweet Never Grow Up. This song is basically just Taylor talking to her younger self and imploring her to never grow up. And it details all of that bittersweetness of becoming an adult, growing older. This is a song I hardly ever listen to because, oh my god, it makes me so sad. The liner note is, "I moved out in July," which I think is a big part of what inspires this. It's so heartbreaking to me that this song about, like, moving out of your parents' house for the very first time is on the same album where she talks about a relationship with a 32-year-old man. Like, I think if that doesn't show just how, like, heartbreaking and manipulative and terrible her relationship with John Mayer was, like, I don't know what else can. Track 9 is the fantastic, incredible Enchanted. This is one of my favorite songs on this album, one of my favorite songs, period. It's basically just about meeting somebody for the first time, experiencing love at first sight, and just wondering if you'll ever see them again. And the song is inspired by the guy from Owl Fucking C. The liner note is Adam, which is referring to Adam Young, who was the lead singer of Owl City at this time. Taylor met him at some party. Afterwards, he emailed her saying he was wonderstruck to meet her, which is why she includes that in the lyrics. I'm wonderstruck, dancing around all alone. After Speak Now came out, after the song was out in the public, Adam Young created a response song that was released on Valentine's Day, 2011. And he sings Enchanted, but like Owl City-ified. And he includes her name. He puts Taylor, I was enchanted to meet you too, in the chorus.
Oh Taylor, I was so enchanted to meet you too. This
night is sparkling. And it comes with this note. Dearest Taylor, I'll be the first to admit I'm a rather shy boy, and since music is the most eloquent form of communication I can muster, I decided to record something for you as a sort of reply to the breathtaking song on your current record. This is what I wanted so badly to tell you in person, but could never quite put into words. Everything about you is beautiful. You're an immensely charming girl with a wonderful heart and more grace and elegance than I know how to describe. You are a true princess from a dreamy fairy tale, a modern Cinderella. I'm terribly sorry it's taken me such a long time to reply, but I figured Valentine's Day was the perfect time to write this note to you and simply say, I was enchanted to meet you too. Love, Adam. Now, this is very sweet, objectively, but it's such an ick. Just such an ick in its truest form. And I think Taylor felt the same exact way because she never commented on this publicly. I'm pretty sure Adam Young said in an interview that she never replied, period. And they never dated, which I think is just so funny that she writes this, like, insanely, like, dramatic, beautiful song about basically meeting, like, the love of your life for the first time. And then he responds and is like, no, I felt the same way. And she's like, oh, this is really embarrassing. Anyway, I'm obsessed. I love this song. Now, the next track is a bit of a controversial song. This is Better Than Revenge. It's inspired by Camille Bell, the actress who quote-unquote stole Joe Jonas from Taylor. And it's a bit slut-shamey, it's a bit woman-blaming, and a song that I'm not confident Taylor will re-record when Speak Now Taylor's version comes out because of this. It kind of set feminism back several years, I think. But that being said, when I'm listening to it, I'm okay to set my staunch feminist beliefs aside for 3 minutes and 40 seconds because it's pop punk perfection. It's very similar to Paramore's Misery Business in a lot of ways. And the lyrics are just like brilliant and cutting and just so terrible but so good, you know? And I'd also like to point out the outro of the song in which she says, "Show me how much better you are." And not only is this incredibly homoerotic, but it's referencing the Jonas Brothers song Much Better that Joe Jonas wrote about Camille Bell and saying she's so much better than Taylor. And the liner note is You Thought I Would Forget. The next song is Innocent. I mentioned this earlier on in the video. This was the song that Taylor performed at the 2010 VMAs because it's basically about her forgiving Kanye for interrupting her at the 2009 VMAs. And like I said before, like, this is a really pretty song, but when you listen to it within that context, I think it's very condescending and weird. Not that I'm a big Kanye fan, certainly not, but just from a more like objective perspective. I see where she was going with it, but I think there's so many references to being like a kid, being naive, being innocent. It just feels very odd for this situation. Those are my thoughts on innocent. The liner note is, life is full of little interruptions, which is kind of hilarious. Track 12 is the incredibly dramatic Haunted. This song is about the moment when you realize that the person you're with is kind of fading or falling out of love with you. And it's got this like really dramatic like rock orchestra sound. It sounds like something that could be in like Phantom of the Opera or something. It is believed that this song is about Joe Jonas and him breaking up with her. As she described in a quote about the song Forever and Always from Fearless, which is confirmed to be about him, she described it as a relationship with someone and just watching him slowly slipping away, which is very much the vibe of this song. And it's very heartbreaking and anxiety inducing and unfortunately all too relatable. It is also believed that this song may have originally been intended for the Twilight New Moon soundtrack, because if you listen to it and you know the plot of Twilight New Moon, it's identical. Like, she might as well have written this specifically for and about Bella and Edward. This is all rumor, this is all hearsay, none of this is confirmed, but some people believe that, yeah, this was supposed to be for the New Moon soundtrack, but after her breakup with Taylor Lautner, they didn't want that drama to overshadow the marketing for the movie, and so they took it out. Again, don't know how true that is, but would be awesome if it was. Whenever I hear the song, to this day, I think of this time in fourth grade when I asked my brother and his then-girlfriend, now his wife, Slay, to help me move my bed and like rearrange my room. And my bed is really big and heavy, and I was like, let me put on some music to hype you guys up. And I put on Speak Now, and they weren't really vibing with any of the songs. They weren't really feeling it. I was skipping around, and then I got to Haunted, and my brother was like, hold on, keep this on, turn it up, what is this, put it on repeat. And I did all of those things. And we listened to Haunted like 10 times in a row while they were moving my bed. And I still think of that to this day. That was probably like 12 years ago. And speaking of that, the liner note is still to this day. Lucky number 13 on this album is, spoiler alert, my favorite song on the whole album, Last Kiss. To this day, I think this is her most heartbreaking breakup song. She literally cried in the studio recording this, and you can hear it in this part, which I'll play.
And it's a beautiful day, and something reminds you.
And this song is certainly about her breakup with Joe Jonas. The liner note is literally forever and always, so there's kind of no getting around that. I would also like to include this clip from the Speak Now World Tour of, I forget what city she was in, it must have been like LA or something. Joe Jonas went to her show. He went to the Speak Now World Tour, and this is her performing Last Kiss to him. She literally had her Lorelai Gilmore, I Will Always Love You karaoke bar moment with Joe Jonas. The final track on the standard version of the album is Long Live. This is a song she wrote for the fans. The liner note is literally for you. It's just all about her gratitude for her fans, and it details all the wonderful things that have occurred in her career thus far, including winning Album of the Year at the Grammys, her first headlining tour, all of the good stuff. A very important moment in Massachusetts history for you is when she performed this song at Gillette Stadium, and it started pouring rain, and it just made for this absolutely gorgeous, beautiful moment. Very iconic. So there are 6 bonus tracks on Speak Now, however 3 of them are just remixes of songs on the original album, so we really only have 3 to cover. So let's power through. The first bonus track is a song called Ours, which, fun fact slash flex, was the song was the surprise song that she sang when I went to see her on the Reputation tour. Every night she did a different kind of deep cut acoustic version of a song, and at my show it was Ours. So I always think of that when I hear this song. And it's just like a sweet song about a love that's criticized from the outside and deciding to just focus on each other and not on the criticism, which is so adorable, so sweet. However, this song is certainly about John Mayer before they broke up. If you set up the lyrics of Ours and Dear John side by side, the parallels are insane and literally send a chill down my spine. The song was released as a single in November 2011 and peaked at lucky number 13 on the Billboard Hot 100. This is another song that I don't think was a huge hit, but it's cute and it did pretty well charts-wise, so slay. The music video shows Taylor as a young professional working in a boring corporate office, reminiscing about a boyfriend, killing time. Then after work, she goes to the airport to pick him up, and it's revealed that he's coming home from the military. Cute, fun, a slay. Next is my favorite bonus track on this album, If This Was a Movie. This is the only song that Taylor didn't write completely by herself. She co-wrote it with Martin Johnson, who was the lead singer of Boys Like Girls, who she had collaborated with on the song Two Is Better Than One. He's got that really hype orchestra that's featured a lot on this album, and it's just about wanting somebody to come back to you like they would if it was a rom-com. And it's just gorgeous. I love this song so much. So good. Next is the song Superman. This is a song I slept on for years. It's rumored to also be about John Mayer pre-breakup, especially because she says, I loved you from the very first day. In the song, the liner note of Dear John is, I loved you from the very first day. So it's basically just about being obsessed with your boyfriend and having to be separate from him for some reason or another. It's super cute, it's adorable, and I love it when I can pretend that the war criminal John Mayer has nothing to do with it. The final bonus tracks are an acoustic version of Back to December and Haunted, and which are gorgeous and beautiful, and the Mind Pop mix, which is literally traumatizing, so we're gonna skip right over that. And that is Speak Now. The Speak Now era was a major moment of transition for Taylor's career and is honestly kind of thought of as a forgotten era in many ways. The hits from this album aren't the essential parts of her discography that had been in past albums, and while the songs are fantastic, there was no love story, no Our Song on Speak Now. I think part of this has to do with the fact that Taylor started getting wrapped up in a lot of controversy, and honestly, the air of controversy surrounding her hasn't left since. She's been admired and shunned by the public in waves for over 12 years now, and this was just the start of it. In particular, this album is coming off the heels of the Kanye incident at the 2009 VMAs, and many people believe that she played up being the victim far too much, that she went over the top with seeking the public sympathy. And again, I'm not a big fan of Kanye whatsoever, but I do kind of agree a little bit. I think people were hard on her, but I also think she needed a little bit of constructive criticism during this time, particularly when you look at the racial implications of the incident. Taylor, whether she intended to or not, and I genuinely don't believe she would intentionally do this, but she leaned into the negative, stereotypical view of white women being victimized by black men that has existed for hundreds and hundreds of years. And again, not that I think what Kanye did was right, but I think this moment was certainly the beginning of a slew of Taylor as the victim narratives, which all had varying degrees of truths and non-truths to them. Taylor as the victim slash good girl is then further cemented by her style during this era. She joked in her recent commencement speech at NYU that, quote, "For the entirety of 2012, I dressed like a 1950s housewife." Taylor really goes for these conservative, mid-century looks during this time, which is partly a way of assuaging the growing belief that because she had dated a handful of high-profile male celebrities, she was a slut. The Taylor Swift has a lot of ex-boyfriends thing has never gone away. It's something she has been shamed for years now, and right around this time of the Speak Now era, when she was just dating like a normal person in their early 20s and writing about those experiences in her music, it was the only thing people knew about her and commented on. So to combat this, she begins dressing like a nun, basically. In addition to all this controversy surrounding her, though, her popularity is simultaneously growing and growing, and during this era, she fully cements herself as a figure in pop culture as her music continues to evolve from strictly country to country pop to pop, which leads us to her biggest tour yet. Taylor announces the Speak Now World Tour in November 2010, and it begins in February 2011 in Singapore. This tour took everything from the Fearless Tour and elevated it to a whole other level. We get more sparkly dresses and hair whipping and costume changes for sure, but now it's just far more intense. Visually, she went for more of a turn-of-the-century boudoir meets Great Depression chic, which very much matches the vibe of the album. Every night on the North American and Australian legs of the tour, she'd write a song lyric or quote from a movie on her arm as a nightly mood ring for how she was feeling. For example, at the Omaha show in May 2011, she had her bestie Selena Gomez's lyric, "You've Got Every Right to a Beautiful Life," on her arm, or the June 2011 show in Foxborough, Mass, when she had the Tim McGraw lyric, "Like love from a drunken sky, confetti falling down all night." The setlist included some of her hits from her past couple of albums, most of the songs from Speak Now, as well as a handful of acoustic covers, including Apologize by One Republic, Drops of Jupiter by Train, I'm Yours by Jason Mraz, etc. In November 2011, the Speak Now World Tour Live album gets released, and it is fantastic. Her vocals begin to vastly improve during this era, and the live version of Dear John is particularly great. Hearing the very beginning of Sparks Fly with the crowd cheering literally gives me chills. It's amazing stuff. In 2011, Taylor starts building her empire. She partners with American Greetings for a line of greeting cards in March, which I was personally obsessed with, and I received several of these for my birthday that year. In October, she partners with Elizabeth Arden to release a perfume called Wonderstruck, as in, I'm Wonderstruck, blushing all the way home. The ad campaign for this has stuck with me for years. I remember seeing these ads on TV and being like, I need perfume to wear to fourth grade. I was given the second perfume called Enchanted by Wonderstruck. Actually, I'm gonna get it right now. This is the perfume. It's Enchanted by Wonderstruck. I don't know if you can see it. Which was the second in the line of perfumes that she did. They're both kind of floral, very, very sweet. Yeah. I don't know. I like it. I wear this sometimes. Say what you will about Taylor Swift, but you cannot deny that she is an incredibly smart businesswoman, and this was just the beginning of her dipping her toe into using her image and influence to expand her empire and make a buttload of money. Now, I consider myself very lucky that I was a preteen when the global sensation known as the Hunger Games came about. It was the kind of thing where you just had to be there, and fortunately, I was there. Wind in my hair, I was there, I remember it all too well. The Hunger Games was my life. I had all the books, I went to the midnight premieres of all the movies, I had a huge poster in my room, I became obsessed with learning archery, really wanted to take archery lessons, and my mom was like, huh? Oh, I also really wanted to French braid my hair the way that Katniss does, but unfortunately I had this horrific bowl at the time. So you can bet that I lost my damn mind when it was announced that Taylor would be featured on the Hunger Games movie soundtrack. She released the first single, Safe and Sound, featuring the Civil Wars in December 2011. This song is this gorgeous, heartbreaking folk ballad, and I had it downloaded on my iPod Touch the moment it was released. The music video for the song was my entire personality in 2012. Taylor's in this long white nightgown walking around barefoot, and the forest starts burning down. It's very Katniss Everdeen coded, so District 12, so Civil Wars obsessed. And the song ended up winning a Grammy in 2013 for Best Song Written for Visual Media, so slay. The second song on this soundtrack is Eyes Open, which was released in March of 2012. This is more of a rock ballad, a little bit more upbeat, but still also devastating. Another monumental slay for District 12. This song had a lyric video and won the Ultimate Award, a Teen Choice Award for Choice Song by a Female Artist. Yeah, this was just the best of both worlds for me in 2012. I mean, it was the Hunger Games, it was Taylor, it was everything. And again, you kind of had to be there, unfortunately. So now we've come to February 2012, the night of the 54th Grammy Awards. Taylor is up for Best Country Solo Performance and Best Country Song, both for Mean, and Best Country Album for Speak Now. And in a colossal slay, Taylor performs Mean, the song inspired by the negative reviews of her last Grammy performance, and she changes the lyrics in the last chorus to "Someday I'll be singing this at the Grammys and all you're ever gonna be is Mean." Taylor ends up winning Best Country Solo Performance and Best Country Song, and don't get me wrong, Mean is fantastic. I was realizing, I don't know if you can see the full shirt. She has Mean written in, like, blood for some reason. It's a fun song, it's a good song. I don't really fully understand why this became the most, like, intensely decorated song from this era when Enchanted is literally on this album. But, you know, what do I know? I'm just someone who dedicates most of my time and energy into thinking about and listening to Taylor Swift. So, you know, what do I know? All right. We've come to everyone's favorite part of the video, the Julia stats. Let's get to it. My favorite song on this album, I already said it, Last Kiss. No, I'll go sit on the floor wearing your clothes. All that I know is devastating. Love this song. It's so beautiful and perfect and stunning and gorgeous, and I love it. My favorite music video, Story of Us. Need I say more? It's one of my favorite videos of hers of all time. So good. My favorite live performance is Dear John at the Speak Now World Tour. Shining like fireworks. Honestly, sometimes if I'm gonna listen to Dear John, I listen to the live version instead, because it's fantastic. And finally, my favorite look from this era, just like with the last video, I could not decide, so I'm gonna cheat and give you two. There's the 2011 ACM Awards, in which Taylor won Entertainer of the Year, and the 2012 Grammys. Both of them are these just gorgeous golden gowns, and she looks absolutely stunning, as always. Thank you again for watching this video. I know it is probably so long, but my empire is growing, and I feel like it is my duty to be as obnoxiously thorough as possible. So that's just the name of the game here. Next time we will be entering my favorite era of all, my favorite album of all. I cannot wait to talk about Red. And I'm sure that video is going to be at least 2.5 hours long. So, buckle in. Peace and love. Thanks for watching. And I'll talk to you next time. Bye.